The 19th Amendment, guaranteeing the woman the right to vote, has a long, complicated history in the United States. It was founded in the mid-19th century by many brave women who believed that women deserved the same rights as men. Rights such as the right to an equal education and employment opportunities, and the right to vote. The 19th Amendment was passed by Congress on June 4, 1919, and ratified August 18, 1920. Brave women like Lucretta Mott, Susan B. Anthony, Lucy Stone, Alice Paul, and Ida B. Wells were some of the leaders in the right for women's rights. This is the story of Elizabeth Cady Stanton and how she led the way. Elizabeth Leads the Way, Elizabeth Cady Stanton and the Right to Vote, written by Tanya Lee Stone, illustrated by Rebecca Gibbon, published by Henry Holt & Company, New York, New York. We do not expect our path will be strewn with flowers of popular applause, but over the thorns of bigotry and prejudice will be our way. Elizabeth Cady Stanton. What would you do if someone told you you can't be what you want to be because you are a girl? What would you do if someone told you your vote doesn't count, your voice doesn't matter, because you are a girl? Would you ask why? Would you talk back? Would you fight for your rights? Elizabeth did. All of these things used to be true back when Elizabeth Cady was a girl, and all of these things might still be true today if Elizabeth hadn't led the way. She was only 4 years old the first time she heard someone, a woman, say, life was better for boys. The woman had come to visit Elizabeth's new baby sister. What a pity she's a girl! How could anyone look at a little baby and feel sad? What could be wrong about being a girl? She was 13 years old when her father, Judge Cady, told a woman whose husband had died that the farm she had spent her whole life working on would be taken from her. Without a husband, the law stated nothing belonged to her. Elizabeth was horrified by this unfairness. She said that the law should be cut out of every book. Judge Cady told her that wouldn't change anything. The law was still the law, and only men were allowed to change the laws. She decided right then and there that she could do anything any boy could do. She jumped over high hurdles on horseback. She rafted across a raging river. She won a prize for being the best in Greek studies. Her father was proud, but he worried about his strong-spirited, rule-breaking daughter. Ah, you should have been a boy. He knew how much easier her life would be, but Elizabeth wasn't interested in easy. At 16, since colleges would not let girls in, Elizabeth begged her father to send her to a girls' school to continue her learning. So, while most young ladies were getting married, washing dishes, doing laundry, and having babies, Elizabeth was studying religion, math, science, French, and writing. Several years later, Elizabeth Cady met Henry Stanton. He was an abolitionist, speaking out against slavery. He understood how unfair it was for people not to have rights or power. He did not laugh when Elizabeth talked about freedom. He did not laugh when Elizabeth said all people shall be able to live the way they choose. And he did not laugh when she told him she would add his name to her own, but would not give up hers just to marry him. So Elizabeth Cady became Elizabeth Cady Stanton, and had babies, cooked meals, washed dishes, mended clothes, and did laundry. She loved her babies, but she did not love cooking and dishes and mending and laundry. One day, her friend Lucretta Mott invited her to lunch. Lucretta had always shared Elizabeth's ideas, all about the things women could do and would do, if only they had the right. The other woman at lunch shared them too. Elizabeth got fired up. She proposed they hold a meeting. A meeting that would gather together lots and lots of women from all around to talk. But what would they talk about? There were so many things that needed to be set straight. Married women couldn't own property or even money they worked to earn. Elizabeth had learned long ago that only men could change the laws, because only men could vote. That was it. That was the one thing that could change everything. If women could vote, they could help change all kinds of laws. This idea was so shocking, so huge, so daring, Elizabeth's friends gasped out loud. If they were flabbergasted, what would other people think? Elizabeth did not waver. She knew voting was the only way to make a difference. Her battle cry for the right to vote rang out. Have it, we must. Use it, we will. Even her Henry thought she had gone too far. But on July 19, 1848, when Elizabeth arrived at the meeting place, she saw for herself that she hadn't. The small church in Seneca Falls, New York, was filled with hundreds of people. Elizabeth read aloud what she and a few other women had written together. Their Declaration of Right and Sentiments challenged the idea from the Declaration of Independence that all men are created equal. When she was finished, she looked into the faces of the crowd and waited. The room was silent, and a rumbling began. It grew louder and louder as people argued whether or not women should be allowed to vote. Word of the meeting spread like wildfire. Newspapers across the country scolded Elizabeth for her boldness, but other women joined her in battle. The idea of women having the right to vote began to buzz in the ears of people from Maine to California. Elizabeth had tossed a stone in the water, and the ripples grew wider and wider and wider. Many said Elizabeth must be stopped, but she was unstoppable. She changed America forever. Elizabeth Cady Stanton died on October 26, 1902. It took 18 more years after her death for women to get the vote. The 19th Amendment went into effect in August of 1920. It was Elizabeth who had gotten the ball rolling. We owe her a huge thank you for her efforts toward this triumph.